the history is probably 70 to 80% fact, and the rest of it's imagination. Because we cannot ever really know for sure everything that took place, or how it took place, or when it took place. And it takes that sort of creative imagination to try and really link the fragmentary pieces that have survived in such a way that we really understand what happened. Now, it just so happens that this Hiss case has been studied to death. And I mean, there have been more books written about the Alger Hiss spy case than any other spy case in history. And they've gone the gamut from those like Smith, John Cabot Smith, who was a great supporter of Hiss, to what is eventually the standard work by the former archivist of the United States, Alan Weinstein. Now, he wrote a great book called Perjury, and he started out believing Hiss was innocent, and he came to the conclusion that he was a spy. And then there is that absolutely wonderful reviewer for the New York Times, Sam Tannenhaus, who's written an outstanding biography, biased, of course, in favor of Chambers, but an extremely well-written biography and really fun reading, and I highly recommend it. But frankly, the best book that was ever written about the trial and about Alger Hiss was the first one, A Generation on Trial by Alastair Cook. If you haven't read it, get it out and read it, because you really will find it not only enjoyable, but you really will understand the whole process. He doesn't help you answer the questions, but he helps you understand actually what took place and when it took place. But in fact, Esther and Whitaker went ahead and bought the farm. That's part of the story of the myriads of facts that come out. It is actually a illustration for the last article that Fawn Brody ever wrote. And Fawn Brody was a remarkable historian who knew that Jefferson was playing around long before anybody else was able to discover that, in fact, he had a liaison with Sally Hemings. She wrote a very good biography of Joseph Smith, and she really did not care for Richard Nixon, as if any of you have read her work. So she chose this photograph because it contains the Evening Star edition in which Hiss was finally, after the second trial, found guilty of 2 counts of perjury. Now remember, he was never convicted of spying. He was convicted of lying. And that becomes a rather interesting question, because he always argued that he hadn't lied. Now what you see on the left is an example of how quickly people are forgotten. I happened to be teaching a course with Garrett Power, who's sitting in the back, and I took one of the students into a lounge at the University of Maryland Law School, and I sat down to talk to her about her paper, and I looked up on the wall, and I said, "That's Alger Hiss." They happened to have a complete set of Sharp's courtroom sketches, lithographs, on the wall, this was one of them, of the second trial, and nobody knew what they were. Now, isn't that fair to say, Garrett? Am I being unfair to anybody? We actually checked with the committee to put them on the wall, and they didn't know what they were. So what basically happened was I helped explain what they were. We borrowed them. We have good images of them. It is a delightful one, because you're seeing the two attorneys. On the left-hand side is Hiss's attorney. On the right-hand side is Murphy, who was the prosecutor. Notice how tall he is, how imposing he was. Right, he was a very clever prosecutor, okay? Because the real culprit and the real story in that case is what's sitting on the desk back there, which is the typewriter. You see Whitaker Chambers from his yearbook at Columbia, which he was thrown out of for writing a play called A Play for Puppets, in which he made fun of Jesus Christ. On the right is, of course, Alger Hiss, and that is from his Johns Hopkins University yearbook. And these are the two contenders in 1948 before the House Un-American Activities Committee. If you come to do a study of your neighborhood, remember that a lot of houses were bought on contract, that they were bought on installments. Now, there's a very good book that looks at it in terms of Not in My Neighborhood, that's been published fairly recently, which tells you a lot about the way in which these contracts were used to do blockbusting and to disrupt the patterns of housing throughout the city. But this was a standard approach to selling a house. And what happened was in June of 1938, Whitaker Chambers and his wife, he didn't call himself Whitaker, he called himself David. If you look closely at your handout, you'll see he signed it David Chambers. His wife's name was Esther. They came and they bought this house on an installment plan. Now, the norm for behavior of aspiring middle-class people in this town were not only to have a townhouse, but also to have a country farm. And so the Chambers also, at the same time, were investing in a piece of property out in Carroll County, which was to become their home. An interesting sidebar, bit of fact about it was that the first person to put a down payment on that farm was Priscilla Hiss. He has immunity because he is in fact testifying before a congressional committee. And so no prosecution can take place with regard to anything that he has to say. So he and Hiss get into this, got back and forth about whether or not Hiss had ever known him, whether this was the same person that Hiss had known. Hiss says, oh, yes, I didn't recognize him. He's got bad teeth, but I now know him as George Crossley, and that's how I knew him. Well, this George Crossley becomes a bugaboo all the way through because nobody except a dealer in pornography has ever talked to Chambers and thought that he called himself George Crossley. So that